Good morning, everyone. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I know I have been on your mind. I've heard lots of people talk about. They were very concerned for me. Thank you for your prayers. As I've told some of you, I was a big dum-dum this week. Took some medications that didn't quite mix with my other medications and caused some feet swelling and pain. But I'm doing better, getting there. So please forgive me if I don't stand very much during the service today. If you feel like you would like to sit down too in respect for me, I understand. Thank you for that solidarity. But I'll be taking my seat for most of the service. So just so I don't cause more pain to me this morning. So I would also ask for continued prayers, just so everything goes down. It's not quite 100% yet, but we're getting there. And also, I would like to encourage you to keep the Jacobson family in your prayers. Received the news yesterday that Joyce passed away yesterday morning, and so we would like to keep them all in your prayers. Services are still pending. We'll let you know as soon as I know what's going on, and we'll celebrate Joyce's life soon and release her into the eternal care of our Lord Jesus. So please keep the Jacobson family in your prayers. If you've looked at the calendar, you'll notice that next week I won't be here. The original plan was for Pastor Jim Scrobo and I to switch pulpits at the end of the month, but because someone up at Blair wanted to see me and she wasn't going to be there at the end of the month, we've decided we are going to do our pulpit swap next Sunday. So you'll get the pleasure of seeing Jim again and reuniting with him and hearing a word from him next week. And I will be up in Blair having a good time with them and meeting the people of Blair Congregational Church. So I hope you have a good time next week with Jim and enjoy him. And I'll report back how the Blair Congregational Church went. And don't worry, I'm not going anywhere. But we just thought it would be a good idea to switch 1 week, and Jim could see you, and he hadn't seen a lot of you for a long time, and I'm sure you'll enjoy seeing him again. Are there any other announcements for the good of the fellowship? We do have a special guest this morning. She's kind of blended in. Maybe you've seen her a little bit before. But we have one of our associate conference ministers with us this morning, the Reverend Sarah Renzel Jones. And I have invited her to come forward and just say a word of greeting on behalf of the conferences.
Good morning, everyone. I just decided to do kind of an informal visit this morning. I actually live here in Omaha, near 144th and Blondo, and so haven't had a chance to come and visit with you all yet since I started in my position. I've been in this role since April of 2021, and here in Omaha since last June of 2021, and so for quite some time, we weren't traveling as conference staff, but now we have resumed travel, and so just wanted to come and worship with you today, get to meet Pastor Alex in person, which I haven't done yet. We've been on some Zoom meetings together, but not in person, and just spend time with you and be able to celebrate morning worship with you today. So I bring you greetings on behalf of the Iowa, Nebraska, and South Dakota conferences. I am an ACM for churches in all three, helping to support congregations, especially that are in times of transition between pastors, and also just help our churches with resources, help support our pastors as they minister to their congregations, and stay in covenant with our churches in the UCC. So it's really good to be here and see all of you, and looking forward to just getting to know you better as we're just kind of in the neighborhood and spending any time we can together. I'll be around after service if anybody wants to talk to me and say hello, but just wanted to bring greetings today since I'm here. So thank you.
All right, if there are no other announcements, would you please rise as you are able, and however you are comfortable doing so, please greet one another in the peace and love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Morning. Let us begin our worship this morning. We're doing a choral call to worship, and then we'll move right into our opening song of praise. We'll do Blessed Be the Name, and then Blessed Be the God of Israel. May be seated. Let us join together in our unison prayer printed in the bulletin or on the screen. Eternal God, who was and is and always will be, you formed us, love us, and give us all we need. We thank you for our relationship with you. By your Holy Spirit, comfort us, renew us, and guide us in truth and grace. We pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Barb. Thank you, Paula. It's always a beautiful song to listen to and sing. Everybody comfortable? I think I am. Our scripture reading this morning, we're reading from the book of Exodus. We're in chapter 3, we're going to read verses 1 through 15. If you're following along in one of the Pew Bibles, it starts on page 41 and then goes to page 42. Hear now what the Spirit, or listen to what the Spirit has to say to us this morning. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers, and I am concerned about their suffering. So I have come down to rescue them from the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land into a good and spacious home, or a good and spacious land, a land flowing with milk and honey, the home of the Canaanites, Hittites, Amorites, Perizzites, Hivites, and Jebusites. And now the cry of the Israelites has reached me, and I have seen the way the Egyptians are oppressing them. So now, go. I am sending you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? And God said, I will be with you. And this will be the sign to you that it is I who have sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you will worship God on this mountain. Moses said to God, Suppose I go to the Israelites and say to them, The God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they ask me, What is his name? Then what shall I tell them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, Say to the Israelites, The Lord, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, has sent me to you. This is my name forever, the name by which I am to be remembered from generation to generation. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. When I was younger, I asked my mom, I guess I could have asked my dad, but I knew my mom knew the answer. So I asked her why she named me Alex instead of the fuller name of Alexander. Believe it or not, I'm not Alexander, I'm just Alex. I guess I was kind of going through some sort of small identity crisis at the time, I don't know. And I remember thinking that Alexander just sounded cooler to me than just Alex. And I guess I wasn't expecting this, but my mom gave a reasonable answer to why she named me just Alex. She said, Everybody's going to call me Alex anyway. They're going to shorten it, whether you're Alexander or Alex. They're going to call you Alex. So she thought, why not just make that my name? Okay, fair enough. And that's why I am just Alex. There aren't exactly a whole lot of famous Alexes in the world. When I Googled famous Alexes, as I was going through many of them, a lot of them were YouTubers or streamers, people I had never heard of before. The only two that I truly recognized was the late Alex Trebek, the famous host of Jeopardy. Is Maddie here? She would have been very proud of, she would have been so proud of that reference, wouldn't she? Because Maddie always asks if I'm going to dress up as Alex Trebek for Halloween. And the other one was Alex Rodriguez, the former Major League shortstop and current media personality. Those are the only two that I actually recognized as famous Alexes. And when I looked up Alex Wolves, that doesn't really make much sense, Alex Wolf in Omaha, believe it or not, there are three of us here in Omaha. But I'm not the most famous one, not that I should be. I think there's a realtor or somebody that's a little bit more famous, an Alex Wolf here in Omaha, but at least there's a couple of us here in Omaha. I'm quite impressed. So what's in a name? A name is what people call you. It's what you respond to. It's what you understand about yourself. From the day we're born, we're assigned this identifier. Some people even get nicknames, different names. When I was learning to walk, I was told by my parents that I had a short-lived nickname, Scooter. And my family called me Scooter because I wasn't quite ready to walk, and so instead of walking, I would scoot across the floor. But I think I probably got quite tired of that pretty quickly, and so I just learned to walk instead. Some people change their name entirely to better suit their identity that they find of themselves. But names aren't just about identifying someone. It's also, I think names can also tell us more about a particular person. Names can have special meaning. The name Alex is of Greek origin and means something like defender or protector of people. I kind of like that, actually. I'm not much of a fighter. I'd probably rather run than fight, but I like the thought that my name, you know, can mean that I'm going to try to help somebody. I'm going to try to protect someone that I love. And so I want to try to live up to that name. Our name is a major part of our identity. Even God has a name. Actually, there are quite a few names attributed to God throughout our Christian scriptures. So today, through the end of August, we're going to look at some of the different names attributed to God, or God attributes to himself through scripture, and look at them and break them down and figure out what they tell us about God. And today we're starting with the most common name attributed to God throughout at least the Hebrew scriptures, and that is the name Yahweh, or as it's sometimes pronounced, Jehovah. While the author of Genesis and Exodus have already used this name of God quite extensively in the books, we receive its origins here in Exodus chapter 3. Chapter 3 starts with Moses caring for his father-in-law's flock in the middle of the wilderness. Now, as I was looking at this, I think it's a little unclear. I think Moses may have gotten a little lost because he finds himself and his flock at the base of Mount Horeb, also known as Mount Sinai, the famous mountain of God, which, at least according to some of my Bible atlases, said it was about 200 miles away from home. Now, 200 miles away for us today may not be as big of a deal, but back in that day, that's quite a distance from home. Was he lost? Or was he going somewhere? Did he feel led by something or someone to go to this mountain? This mountain is a prominent setting throughout the book of Exodus. and it hosts some of the book's key moments, first here with the calling of Moses. And on this mountain, Moses sees a bush on fire. But miraculously, the fire is not consuming the bush. And I think this is an unusual sight that catches Moses' attention, as it should. When was the last time you burnt something, had a fire, had a campfire or something? Fires take a lot of fuel, and it often burns things very, very quickly. I don't think a bush, probably a dry bush, would last very long if caught on fire. But here it was. It was burning and burning, but not burning at the same time. Both Moses and the author cannot explain this supernatural event. And so Moses moves closer to inspect this burning bush. And there, he is met by God. And God initiates this encounter by calling out to Moses, "Moses, Moses." And Moses responds in a common way found throughout the Old Testament when God calls out to someone. Moses says, "Here I am." Does Moses know who he's speaking to? Does he know that that's a common way that people address God? Is this perhaps the first time Moses has encountered God? Maybe it's not. I don't know. But God sets the tone of this encounter immediately. In verse 5, God gives Moses two commands. He says, "Don't come any closer." And he says, "Take off your sandals." Now, I can get the "don't come any closer." That one might make sense. You don't want to get burned or anything. But why the command to take off sandals? Actually, you know what? I can kind of get that today, because removing my feet might help my feet feel better today. Removing my shoes might make my feet feel better. But why must Moses take off his sandals? Well, removing one's sandals was a sign of reverence or a sign of respect in the Middle East region of the world, actually a practice that continues today. Moses finds himself in the presence of God Almighty, the creator and ruler of the universe. He is in a holy space. And God deserves reverence and respect. It reminds me of a story when I was in college. We were doing a preaching class, and one of my fellow classmates I didn't really think of it. When she would give her practice sermons, she would take off her shoes. And the rest of us thought, maybe her feet hurt too, I don't know. But she said, she referred to this text where when she would get up to preach, she was in a holy space and would take off her shoes. So every time I read this text, I think of her taking off her shoes, ready to preach the word of God. Once Moses is aware of whose presence he is in, in verse 6, God then announces himself to Moses by saying that he is the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses immediately hides his face in reverence. And God continues to speak, offering compassion and hearing the misery and cries from his oppressed people. God confirms to Moses that he has been there the whole time. Even though it seems as if he's been silent, God was not distant, he was not detached from the Israelites. But there, listening, knowing, hearing. And through this miraculous appearance in a burning bush, God boldly declares that he is sending Moses back to Egypt, and through Moses is going to deliver the Israelites into a land flowing with milk and honey. Now you would think that Moses would be jumping with joy all the way back to Egypt with this good news. God is finally going to do something about the Israelites' woes and suffering. Finally, right? But that's not how Moses sees his calling. Instead, Moses begins to question God's wisdom on the subject. not once, not twice, but actually five times within this encounter. We don't read the entire encounter today, but five times Moses has questions, doubts that he is really the person for the job. And we read of two of Moses' questions today. Moses' first question is, in all honesty, kind of a reasonable one. Who am I to do this? Moses asks. Now, this question partially reflects Moses' lack of self-confidence, but I think it may also reflect his understanding of God's role in all of this. Is it not God's role to save his people? I mean, we humans are so limited in what we can do. I mean, can only God do it? Isn't that what God's supposed to do? But in verse 12, God does not claim that Israel is going to be saved because of Moses' natural skill or charisma. Rather, God assures Moses that Israel will be saved because of God's faithfulness. Moses' faults ultimately don't matter, because God promises in verse 12, I will be with you. But the promise of God's faithfulness isn't quite enough to convince Moses. Not only is Moses concerned about his own qualifications, but apparently he's concerned about his shaky perception with the Israelites. He probably has in the back of his mind how, if he'll show up before the people of Israel, how they'll remember that he grew up as an Egyptian, how he even grew up in Pharaoh's household. They'll remember that he committed murder, that he's a wanted man. Why would they trust him? Moses also anticipates that the Israelites will ask him about God's name. Now, this is an interesting one. Why does Moses anticipate this specific question? Does Moses not know God's name? That could be part of it. Or maybe he already knew, but he just wanted to make sure. When asked about the divine name, God responds by saying in verse 14, the very famous words, I am who I am. And perhaps anticipating confusion upon Moses' part, God then explains further, this is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am sent me to you. Now there has been much, much debate surrounding God's name here, namely what it means and how to pronounce it. When translated from the original Hebrew, God's name is usually written in the English letters. It's usually used with YHWH. And you're wondering, well, that's how do you pronounce that? Well, that's a good question, because the ancient Hebrew language didn't supply vowels like we do in English. And so modern translators often have to supply assumed vowels. And so the most commonly supplied vowels are an A after the Y and an E between the W and H, which usually leads to the pronunciation of Yahweh. This name, Yahweh, comes from the Hebrew meaning to be. And that's why it's translated I am, or the full version, I am who I am. Kind of an interesting side note. In later biblical times, the divine name was deemed so holy and so holy that it should not be pronounced in public. So whenever the divine name came across in Scripture, the reader would substitute the name with the title Adonai, or the Lord. And this is still reflected in our Bibles today. When you see the word the Lord and it's written in all capital letters, that's, at least in the original Hebrew, the divine name, Yahweh. Now, while the most commonly accepted way to understand God's answer to Moses' question is this phrase, I am who I am. There's perhaps another way to understand God's answer. I create what I create. Or I am the one who causes things to pass. I think this potential way of understanding God's name maybe best helps answer the heart of Moses' question. I doubt Moses really was unsure about God's name. I'm sure he had heard it at one point or another. I think he more asked about God's name, seeking assurance that God will do what he says. And so God answers with that assurance. I am who I am, or I am the one who causes things to pass. God is the one who causes things, that makes things happen. And despite Moses' objections and doubts, this name reveals that God always delivers on what God promises. The great I am, the God of our fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, is the one who has gone before and who is with us now. This name of God, Yahweh, I am who I am what causes to be, reveals to us that God is the one who always was and always is and always will be. This name shows us that on one level, God is always, is eternal, and stands as the highest being, is beyond our understanding in some ways. Yet this is the name that God shared with the Israelites. This is God's covenant name, the name by which they knew God by. The name by which they could call out to God with. And the name by which we can also know God. By introducing the divine name to Moses, God shows that God can relate to us. It's like when you meet someone for the first time. You exchange names. I'm Alex. What's your name? By exchanging names, in a way, you begin a relationship with that person. By knowing each other's name, you can know each other. You can understand each other. While God is big and eternal and beyond our limited understanding, God is yet close and personal. By this name, God shows that he wants to be with us, to be a part of our lives. By sharing the divine name, God shows that he is not some far-off entity. God has not created us and then left us on our own. God is relational. God is compassionate. God knows our pains, our hurts, our troubles. God also knows our successes, our joys, what makes us happy. Our God, who is so big and yet so close at the same time, is full of love and mercy, is close to listen to us, is close to commune with us. Our God is so close to us that God came to us and became one of us in the person of Jesus. And through Jesus, God walked with us, ate with us, worked with us, played with us, was simply with us. This is who Yahweh is. This is our loving, our big, yet intimate God. So if you're ever feeling alone, if you're ever wondering if God is far off, not listening, not caring, not concerned about what you're going through, not cared about any of your circumstances, we can remember that our God is the great I am. I am who I am, the one who causes things to pass. The one who we know by name. And we can remember the words of the psalmist from Psalm 145. Yahweh, I am, is near to all who call upon him. Let us pray. O eternal and loving God, what a joy it is to know that you are so wonderful and majestic, yet you personally know us and watch over us and care for us. And we thank you that we can know you, especially we can know you through Jesus. And it's in his precious name I pray. Amen. As we've been doing throughout the summer, we've been listening to what you would like to sing, and so you are invited to rise and join together in our hymn, How Great Thou Art. Please be seated. At this time, I invite you to join with me in prayer. O Almighty God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Friend, we are so thankful for the blessings you have showered upon us. You have blessed us with our family and friends. You have blessed us with food on our tables, roofs over our heads, clothes on our backs. Yet sometimes we take these blessings for granted. Help us to remember the source of these blessings. Help us to be grateful for all that you do for us, O God. And help us to live lives that are full of thanksgiving. O God, we pray for blessings upon your congregation here in Northwest Hills. We pray for healing upon those who are ill. We especially lift up Doris Norgaard as she recovers from whatever her illness, whatever ails her. We pray for Fred Scott as he recovers from, or as he endures his journey with Alzheimer's. We ask that you comfort those who are grieving. We especially pray for the Jacobson family as they mourn the death of Joyce. May your comforting spirit surround them. We pray that you reassure those who feel troubled and frightened by what the future may hold. May you anoint us by your Spirit. Empower us to do your work here in our community of Omaha, which sometimes may be difficult, sometimes joyful, but always holy. Be in the words that we speak, the cards that we send, the phone calls that we make. May we be bearers of the Holy Spirit's flame, warming people's hearts, providing hope, lending comfort, and in all of these things, bringing you glory. O gracious God, we also offer to you the prayers of our hearts, the prayers that we don't have words for, but we know that you hear and understand. We pray all of this to you, O merciful God, in the power of the Holy Spirit, and in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we've been doing for quite some time now, we're not passing the offering plates, but our offering plate is in the back by the sound booth, if you feel so led to give. And in response to God's blessings showered upon us, and our returning of some of those gifts to the work of Christ's church, please rise as you are able and let us join together in our doxology. Let us join together in our prayer of dedication. O holy God, bless these gifts and offerings we bring before you. Help us use these treasures faithfully, our time wisely, and our talents to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join together in our hymn, O for a World. May you go from this place knowing that you are known and loved and cared for by our God, who is I Am. And as you go from this place, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you today, tomorrow, and always. Go in peace. Amen.